So, hello everyone. My name is Corey and I am studying a Bachelor of Design, majoring in graphic design, digital design and marketing. So my project over the summer has been the Fremantle Harbour animated panorama project. Now, before we begin, I'd like to acknowledge the Wadjuk people, the traditional custodians of the land in which this presentation is taking place on, and pay my respects to their elders, past, present and emerging, for they hold the memories, culture and hopes of Indigenous Australia. So the aim of my project was to create a wide-angle animated panoramic view of the Fremantle Harbour as viewed from the Fremantle Ports Administration Building using a combination of historical and modern photography. The project was working with the Fremantle Ports to source eligible historical images and digitally distort, transform, merge, and stitch these images together to create a wide-angle panoramic composition, which could then be used for exhibition purposes by Fremantle. The process of image stitching involves combining two or more images together using a careful manual image stitching process, which I'll outline in this presentation. The project aims to present historical highlights of the Fremantle Harbour to further present the history of Fremantle Harbour from 1964 to current day. Panoramic photography is seen as a very visually dynamic way of telling a story. It can be a complex way to visualize a landscape and immerse the viewer into an immersive environment. And the intent of this project is that we create a wide-angle panorama that presents the visualize the history of the harbour and provide insight into moments of interest. So providing some background, the Historical Panoramas Project has a website which was first launched in 2016. This project sourced photographs from the State Library of Western Australia and found images from 20 different locations around Perth and Fremantle and created them into a visually engaging website which is available to view. In 2021, so just last year, another summer internship program undertook a analysis of the history of the Fremantle and proposed a historic panoramic display of the Fremantle Harbour, which has inspired this project. Now, for those that you don't know a lot about the history of Fremantle, the Fremantle Ports Administration Building was opened in 1964, and from its view has seen an expansive amount of activity over the past 57 years. From there, there has been a wide range of ships that have come and visited port from that time, from naval visits, royal visits, cruise ships, and the like. So we will be finding historical photographs captured from a high vantage point and creating them in this presentation. So the objectives is to work with Fremantle Ports to find eligible historical images taken from the observation deck on level 8 of the Fremantle Ports Administration Building, and then identify significant historical events of the Fremantle Harbour and image stitching these selected images into a panoramic video sequence. Creative techniques will be explored to essentially create a visual narrative on an evolving harbour landscape. And the project is expected to be used for the Fremantle Ports for exhibition uses. So, to give you an idea, I wanted to show you this image of the Royal Yacht Britannia in 1963 of Queen Elizabeth II and the Duke of Edinburgh. So this is the only image that has been found taken from a high vantage point. And so what we were trying to imagine is what the rest of the scene could look like, given that this is the only image. So using a little bit of magic, we've been able to stitch it and create something like this. Now here's another image taken of the USS Missouri in 1991. A very important naval visit at the time. And so using identifying a combination of historical imagery and a little bit of magic again, we now would do a similar thing. Now that was the only image taken, and we've had to identify images taken around a similar time to create a composition like this. So how do we achieve this? So there's a six-step process. So the first step is identifying those historical photographs taken from a high vantage point, determining a location which is most suitable for the creation of the panorama, finding where the most images have been taken from, then taking a modern day panorama from that view, and then researching the history of the Fremantle Harbour and highlighting those significant events, and then digitally merging and stitching these together, and then using a creative narrative to create an added sense of interest and impact. So the first step is identifying the historical photographs. During the length of the internship, I was given the privilege of looking through the photographic archive from the Fremantle Ports collection with permission from the Fremantle Ports archivist, Alan Pearce. So together we were able to identify around approximately 500 historical images taken from the observation deck. So some of these, and then through that we were able to identify around approximately 100 historical moments. So some of those historical moments may have had a lot of images taken and other might have been just a single moment. So we've kind of defined this as that most of the historical images taken were opportunistic and not really of a panoramic nature, because back then film photography was very expensive. So given these two examples, seen here of the Blumenthal on the top and the Queen Frederica during the immigration period, those were the only images taken and the rest of the scene has not been captured around the same time. So the next stage of the process is to determine a location with which most of these images are taken from. So from the observation deck, there are three viewpoints: the north corner, the west corner, and the tower. The west corner offers views of the entry to the port, such as the slipway, forest landing, A-shed, and Northmore Lighthouse. And the north corner looks out onto Victoria Quay, B-shed, C-shed, D-shed, the CBH silos before they were demolished, and the North Quay off in the distance. So using those three possible viewpoints identified, we have now have to determine the most suitable for the creation of this panorama. So using those two viewpoints, the west corner and the north corner, because the north corner is kind of in the middle and you can see both viewpoints from that higher angle. So what we've done in initial test is overlaid those historical images onto the west corner panorama and the north corner panorama. And from that, we're able to identify 39 images taken from the west corner and 57 images taken from the north corner. So we can see that most of the photographers during the time were taking photos of that north corner. As you can see, it's far more expansive and there's a greater opportunity for taking, capturing the activity of the port. So this test also showed a few challenges as well throughout the project. Given that there was no historical panoramas taken back then and film photography was quite expensive, you can see that there's two very particular areas where these photographs show up. And often there's a gap here and on the foreground, because from the observation deck, it's very hard to kind of lean over and get a view of the foreground. So using this test, we then had to create a modern day panorama. So traditionally taking a panorama, if you're unaware, is capturing from a single viewpoint, standing with your camera on a fixed tripod and moving the camera and rotating around. Now, we've identified two viewpoints, which presents a very big challenge when we're wanting to incorporate images from the west corner and the north corner. So you can see here in these examples that when you capture a panorama from the west side and then also from the north corner, you can see that the perspective changes of B shed here. So if you can imagine yourself standing on the observation deck and physically moving from point A to point B, your perspective changes slightly and the scale of objects in the foreground also change. So in an experiment, I had to try and capture a panorama using both viewpoints. So by carefully moving across from point A to point B, the west corner to the north corner, we were able to create a new composition which looked like this. So it doesn't look like much, but you can see now we have a balanced view of the panorama of the harbour, and now we can incorporate photographs which have taken it from the west corner and also from the north corner. So the next stage is researching those historical moments. So with Alan Pearce, we were able to identify 31 historical moments from those original 500 images collected, following some certain project criteria to make sure that it's suitable for the project. So we need to make sure that they're observed from the observation deck, that they are of high quality and eligible to be reproduced on a large scale, such as the cylinder display, and that they're eligible for image stitching. Some examples below, you have the Queen visiting during her Jubilee tour in 1977, a Mexican tour ship in 2006, and a image titled A Busy Working Port featuring the ship Kibali in 1966. So next stage is to digitally merge and stitch these images together. So for those that you are unaware, I've been working with Adobe Photoshop, which is a powerful software used for image stitching, graphic design, animation, digital art. And this has been the main software used to create these panoramas. So a variety of tools have been used because we've discovered that automatic image stitching is not really usable in this option because we're working with historical images that have been taken around a different time. So manual image stitching is required. So the tools used for manual image stitching are object selection, magnetic lasso tool, and the polygonal lasso tool. Those tools are helping with the selection of images. So when you put two images together, they can, and you select your features, you turn them into layer masks, which act as kind of like an eraser for the image, but preserving the original information. The two prints often were of different colors, so we used color correction and selective color tools to identify differences within color and creating a seamless transition between two prints. And the final step was to use the bicubic transformation tool and other transform distort tools to distort and manipulate the scale of certain objects, because as we know, not all images are taken from the exact point. Often some images might have taken a few meters away or further behind, so those tools are useful to match these two historical images together. So going back to our example that I showed at the start, here are two other images which have been identified that have been capturing alternative viewpoints of the harbour around a similar time. And you can see that the features kind of overlap. So we have the HMS Kent arriving in 1963 around the same time as the Royal Visit, and the Sea Search at Sea Shed here in 1965. So when these two images are overlapped, you can see that the features are crossing over each other, but as we've addressed before, this process is not very easy with automatic image stitching. The Photoshop tool that is used for automatic image stitching is called PhotoMerge, and quite simply, the software will not be able to detect that these images are compatible with each other. So I've come up with some manual image stitching principles to help identify if these images are suitable for image stitching. So we need to make sure that the images are taken from the same location, that they're taken of a high quality, as a lot of images may be preserved at low res, or there might be image grain or noise distortion, that the features overlap each other, which we can see here. There is a crossover in the B shed, in the C shed up here, and we can kind of approximate that we can blend the background together as well. And a very important part of this process is making sure that there's a similarity in the time of day and weather. A lot of photographs may have been taken during sunset or sunrise, which creates very strong shadows that project onto, particularly here at C shed and D shed. So when you're combining two images taken at different times of the day, you have a change in the shadows and it looks very obvious. And then with weather particularly, sometimes there might be rain in the background that's captured, and then when you're transferring, or some kind of haziness. So when you're combining these two images, it creates some kind of issue and you'll be able to see it. And the last thing is making sure that there's no minimal lens distortion. So using those principles, and we've been able to confirm them here, we get something that looks like this. A new panoramic sequence that is optimized for large-scale viewing. So the last step is to get creative. So the image is doesn't really tell a story without providing some more creative options explored. So we've been able to do look at a range of visual techniques, and visual narrative is basically the way of telling story through animation, photography, textures, for example, that can help create an added sense of impact and interest. So here is a sample from my project. As you can see, additional photographs have been included in the narrative, which have been texturized using Adobe stock textures that allude to their kind of historical importance and help reinforce the historical scene. The project title has been included at the top so that viewers that are coming and seeing the sequence know exactly what they're looking at. There's been titles and descriptions included to provide insight for those that don't know the history of the Fremantle Harbour. There has been a slight animation added in some of those historical photographs, an animated timeline at the bottom, which has been created in Adobe After Effects, and that details the year that the event has taken, as well as some annotations, which you can see here, pointing out moments of interest captured in the photograph. So the outcomes, we've been able to identify 107 eligible historical panoramas or photographs that can be created into, that can be image stitched together to create a new composition. In this project, we've been able to present 31 significant historical moments, as I wouldn't have had time to work on 107 throughout the length of this internship. The next step was successfully merging and digitally stitching these historical photographs, and creative approaches were explored to improve visual narrative. Now, I showed this to the Fremantle Ports, and they seem pretty happy with the project, and they plan to use it for an upcoming exhibition. Their Maritime Day is coming up soon, and I'm hoping they use it for that. So, future work. As I outlined before, additional historical photographs could be added. So I've just kind of included the ones that are of historical importance so that the audience can resonate and relate to them. There can be some optimization for website use. So this could be the rescaling of text and of photos to make it optimized for website use. And then we can also include other archival collections such as video, audio, and voiceover to enhance the storytelling. I would like to thank some people that have helped me throughout the length of this internship. Firstly, Associate Professor Andrew Woods. He has been amazing, academic knowledge and historical knowledge, and it's been a really great pleasure to work with. Alan Pearce, the Fremantle Ports archivist, he has an immense amount of knowledge on the history of the harbour, and I wouldn't have been able to do this project without him. Dr. Jolie Tay, for creative advice and support throughout the project. Wesley Lamont for technical advice. It's been a pleasure to work with you too. And the Fremantle Ports Corporate and Community Relations for their support and for funding the project. Thank you.